For verily I say unto you, till heaven and earth pass, one jot or one tittle shall in no wise pass from the law till all be fulfilled.
Hello everybody out there. This is the tittle of the day for today. And today it's over, do you feel terrible about your sins? Okay? Or your transgressions or your iniquities, okay? And I do think that we should feel, terrible about our transgressions and our iniquities, but our sins, you know, are washed away by Jesus, and we know there's a difference between those three things. But also, I guess we should feel terrible about them, right? It's because I don't like to tell people to dwell on their sins, but at the same time, people need to repent and turn from their sins, their iniquities, their transgressions, right? So they don't become reprobate like Romans 1. So that's what I want to talk about today. Do you feel terrible about your sins? And should you do that? And what does God feel about that? So first, let's look at Psalms 51, 1 through 14, and see how David felt about his sins, okay? And we know David had a man murdered. David was a man of war. He had blood on his hands to the point to where he couldn't even build the temple. He was an adulterer. He did a lot of things, you know, that he had a lot of sins, transgressions, and iniquities, right? But he also always laid them at the foot of the Lord, right? And asked him for strength, okay? So let's listen to that, Psalms 51, 1 through 14.
Psalm 51. To the chief musician, a psalm of David, when Nathan the prophet came unto him, after he had gone into Bathsheba.
Have mercy upon me, O God, according to thy loving kindness. According unto the multitude of thy tender mercies, blot out my transgressions. Wash me thoroughly from mine iniquity, and cleanse me from my sin.
So David is admitting right there that he's got all three. He's got transgression, he's got iniquity, and he's got sin. And he needs to be cleansed of all of them. And only the blood of Jesus can do that, right? They can cleanse that away and fix your DNA and fix everything. Your body, the water, the spirit, you know, the blood, all of it fixed through Jesus Christ, right?
For I acknowledge my transgressions, and my sin is ever before me.
So he acknowledges it, and he wants to, get away from it. Right, but he is acknowledging it, you see, right? Even though, you know, think about the connection that David was a man after God's own heart, right? And so he has this connection, and yet he is admitting these things. He knows he needs to repent of these things.
Against thee only have I sinned and done this evil in thy sight, that thou mightest be justified when thou speakest, and be clear when thou judgest.
Right, and he knows he's going to be judged, and Jesus is the judge, right? We go back to John 5, like all judgment has been given to the Son, so Jesus is the judge. So we know that it's righteous how he judges us, but we also know that he loves us, right? Okay.
Behold, I was shapen in iniquity, and in sin did my mother conceive me. Behold, thou desirest truth in the inward parts, and in the hidden part thou shalt make me to know wisdom.
Right.
Purge me with hyssop, and I shall be clean. Wash me, and I shall be whiter than snow.
Amen, right? Our garments will be white, right?
Make me to hear joy and gladness, that the bones which thou hast broken may rejoice.
Amen.
Hide thy face from my sins, and blot out all mine iniquities. Create in me a clean heart, O God, and renew a right spirit within me. Cast me not away from thy presence, and take not thy Holy Spirit from me.
Amen.
Restore unto me the joy of thy salvation, and uphold me with thy free spirit.
Right, the free spirit of the Holy Ghost and salvation, Yeshua, Jesus Christ, right? So you see, David admits all of these things that he's done, you know, even though he still lives in with Bathsheba for a while after that, even has sons and things, right? Has children. So, but see, he admits it, and he knows he needs a Savior, okay? And that's how we should deal with our sins, our iniquities, our transgressions. We deal with them. We confess them to the Lord Jesus Christ. He's already finished the work, but at the same time, through our acknowledgement of it, it helps us not to become reprobate, right? And to admit that we need a Savior and how loving and merciful the Father is, right?
Then will I teach transgressors thy ways, and sinners shall be converted unto thee.
See, what happens when you do that, like what David's doing right now by confessing all of this, shows us an example of how to be with other people if we admit our sins and you know, say, oh yeah, I've gone through that too, and this and that, but I came out on the other side of it. And you might repent 1,000 times in a day, but it's the repenting heart, you know, that you may mean it that one time, but then led into temptation and fall short. But the thing is to always get back up, right? Come again to yourself, like the prodigal son does. He comes again to himself and realizes who he is and goes back to his Father. Okay.
Deliver me from blood guiltiness, O God, thou God of my salvation, and my tongue shall sing aloud of thy righteousness.
Right? And I think it's interesting how he knows that he needs his inward parts clean. It says in verse 6, behold, you desire truth in the inward parts, in the mind and in the heart, right? In the hidden part, you shall make me to know wisdom. Okay, so it's like even your DNA and all that stuff is fixed through the wisdom of the Holy Ghost, right, through what Jesus did. And if you look here, deliver me from blood guiltness, okay? Oh God, you God of my salvation, Yeshua, Jesus Christ, the blood guiltness that we were born with through what came into the world through Adam and Eve, the sin, right, that was broken in the DNA, the blood guiltness. You see that? Okay. So see how David felt about his sins, and he admitted them to God, he repented, and look how it builds us up faith, okay? He felt terrible about his sins and iniquities and transgressions. And we shouldn't dwell on them, but we should use them for a testimony, but also for, you know, getting us closer to God, to admitting we need a Savior. God, Jesus, you know, is a terrible God, it says, okay? Now, what that really means is he's awesome in his nature, but at the same time, he's terrible to the wicked, okay? And to the evil, and to Satan, and all of that. And we'll see how he feels in Zephaniah 2:11-15. God is a terrible God in his works and his doing. So we can see that first in Zephaniah 2.
The Lord will be terrible unto them, for he will famish all the gods of the earth, and men shall worship him, every one from his place, even all the isles of the heathen.
So the Lord will be terrible to them, for he'll starve, get rid of even the gods of the earth, okay? Even the so-called gods, they call themselves gods, fallen angels, all these so-called things. He'll starve them. He'll cause them to go into famine. And it's like demons, they go into dry places, right? And they thirst and they hunger, but they're never fulfilled. So you see how he causes them to do that. And even the isles of the heathen, which are nations, the unbelieving nations, will worship him. And see how he's terrible to them, but terrible, but yet awesome at the same time, okay?
Ye Ethiopians also, ye shall be slain by my sword. And he will stretch out his hand against the north and destroy Assyria, and will make Nineveh a desolation and dry like a wilderness. And flocks shall lie down in the midst of her, all the beasts of the nations. Both the cormorant and the bittern shall lodge in the upper lintels of it. Their voice shall sing in the windows. Desolation shall be in the thresholds, for he shall uncover the cedar work. This is the rejoicing city that dwelt carelessly, that said in her heart,
I am, and there is none beside me.
Right, so it's Babylon the Great. It's goddess worship. You know, I even have to deal with somebody on YouTube who's a woman who it thinks that she's God, right? Like, so literally it's goddess worship. It's always been going on. It's Isis, it's, you know, Columbia, okay? It's all of that stuff. It always goes back to Osiris. It always goes back to the fallen angels. They want to be worshipped as God. And notice how it says, I am, that said in her heart, I am. and there is none besides me. So that's the wicked, that's the evil, that's how the Father feels about it, how terrible he's going to be to them if they don't turn, right?
How is she become a desolation, a place for beasts to lie down in? Everyone that passeth by her shall hiss and wag his hand.
Alright, so you take that, compare it to like what happens to Jezebel, what happens to Babylon, what happens to Babylon the Great in Revelations, okay? It's very interesting to look at that. But you see how he can be a terrible God. We can see that also in Deuteronomy 10:17-22, in his works and doing, he can be a terrible God.
For the Lord your God is God of gods and Lord of lords, a great God, a mighty and a terrible, which regardeth not persons nor taketh reward.
Okay, so you see all of that. He's the Lord of lords, right? God is the God of gods, a great God, a mighty and a terrible, which regards not persons. Okay, he's not a respecter of persons. He's awesome. He's awe-inspiring at the same time as the Lord of hosts, the Lord of armies. You know, he can take everything out if he wants to very easily because he's God.
Okay. He doth execute the judgment of the fatherless and widow, and loveth the stranger in giving him food and raiment.
But it, see, and that's Jesus, right? You see, at the same time, he is terrible to them, to the wicked, to the evil, sudden destruction comes upon them. But to us, he's loving, he's kind, he's merciful, okay? And he is all inspiring to us, awesome to us, but to them, he's terrible. You see? Okay, all right.
Love ye, therefore, the stranger, for ye were strangers in the land of Egypt. Thou shalt fear the Lord thy God. Him shalt thou serve, and to him shalt thou cleave and swear by his name.
Jesus.
He is thy praise, and he is thy God, that hath done for thee these great and terrible things which thine eyes have seen.
Right, so see what they saw in Egypt. They saw the plagues. It was terrible to the Egyptians, but it was awe-inspiring to them. You see, great to the Israelites, it was great. To the Egyptians, not so much, right? The Father was even destroying the Egyptian gods through each of the plagues, right? Okay.
Thy fathers went down into Egypt with 70 persons, and now the Lord thy God hath made thee as the stars of heaven for multitude.
Okay, so you see that? I mean, he can be awesome. In his, so he can be awesome in his works and doings. We can also see that in Psalm 66, it says this.
Psalm 66, to the chief musician, a song or psalm.
Make a joyful noise unto God, all ye lands. Sing forth the honor of his name, make his praise glorious. Say unto God, how terrible art thou in thy works! Through the greatness of thy power shall thine enemies submit themselves unto thee.
Again, I just have to keep saying that he's terrible to them, but he's awe-inspiring, awesome to us, right? I just think that's cool, right? And so in his works and his doing, he is that way, but also he is awesome in his love and his forgiveness and his mercy and his salvation, right?
All the earth shall worship thee and shall sing unto thee. They shall sing to thy name, Selah.
Come and see the works of God. He is terrible in his doing towards the children of men. He turned the sea into dry land. They went through the flood on foot. There did we rejoice in him. He ruleth by his power forever. His eyes behold the nations. Let not the rebellious exalt themselves.
Amen.
Selah.
Oh, bless our God, ye people, and make the voice of his praise to be heard, which holdeth our soul in life and suffereth not our feet to be moved.
Amen.
For thou, O God, proved us, thou hast tried us, as silver is tried. Thou broughtest us into the net, thou laidst affliction upon her loins. Thou hast caused men to ride over our heads. We went through fire and through water, but thou broughtest us out into a wealthy place. I will go into thy house with burnt offerings. I will pay thee my vows, which my lips have uttered and my mouth hath spoken when I was in trouble. I will offer unto thee burnt sacrifices of fatlings with the incense of rams. I will offer bullocks with goats. Selah.
Come and hear, all ye that fear God, and I will declare what he hath done for my soul.
Amen, right?
I cried unto him with my mouth, and he was extolled with my tongue.
Again, back to David expressing, you know, his iniquity, his sin, his transgression, but he knows that how awesome and how terrible the, you know, God can be, and but how he's merciful and loving and kind at the same time.
If I regard iniquity in my heart, the Lord will not hear me. But verily God hath heard me. He hath attended to the voice of my prayer.
Amen, amen.
Blessed be God, which hath not turned away my prayer, nor his mercy from me.
Right, so his mercy does not turn from us, even though we're in the iniquity even, right? Okay, now to end it, let's look at Psalms 47. This is a lot of Psalms, I know, but it just talks about the same type of stuff. And I just love all the books of Psalms. They're awesome. Okay, here we go, Psalms 47.
Psalm 47. To the chief musician, a psalm for the sons of Korah.
Oh, clap your hands, all ye people. Shout unto God with the voice of triumph. For the Lord Most High is terrible. He is a great king over all the earth. He shall subdue the people under us.
Amen.
And the nations under our feet.
Even Satan will be crushed under our feet, plus Jesus' feet, right? It says that that Jesus will crush his head, but also if you read in Romans, at the end of Romans, it says that he will soon crush Satan under our feet.
He shall choose our inheritance for us, the excellency of Jacob, whom he loved. Selah. God is gone up with a shout, the Lord with the sound of a trumpet.
That's Jesus, right? He went up with a shout, the sound of a trumpet, and he'll come back with the sound of the trumpet, right? Amen.
Sing praises to God, sing praises. Sing praises unto our King, sing praises.
Amen.
For God is the King of all the earth. Sing ye praises with understanding. God reigneth over the heathen. God sitteth upon the throne of his holiness. The princes of the people are gathered together, even the people of the God of Abraham. For the shields of the earth belong unto God. He is greatly exalted.
He's greatly exalted, right? So, well, we shouldn't feel terrible about our lives. We should be all inspired by the terrible, awesome God, you know, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost, Jesus, and his salvation, God's love, and the comfort of the Holy Ghost. And we should but confess those things, use them as a testimony, you know, just love everyone, and even you love helps other people through everything, right? Okay, and I don't know, I just like this a lot. This is a good one. So I hope y'all enjoy it. Wake and watch for Yeshua. God is love, and I love God. Amen.